The Auroras of Autumn. 1. This is where the serpent lives, the bodiless. His head is air. Beneath his tip, at night, eyes open and fix on us in every sky. Or is this another wriggling out of the egg? Another image at the end of the cave, another bodiless for the body's slough. This is where the serpent lives. This is his nest. These fields, these hills, these tinted distances, and the pines above and along and beside the sea. This is form gulping after formlessness. Skin flashing to wished for disappearances, and the serpent body flashing without the skin. This is the height emerging and its base. These lights may finally attain a pole in the midmost midnight and find the serpent there, in another nest, the master of the maze of body and air and forms and images, relentlessly in possession of happiness. This is his poison, that we should disbelieve even that. His meditations in the ferns, when he moved so slightly to make sure of sun, made us no less assure. We saw on his head, black beaded on the rock, the flecked animal, the moving grass, the Indian in his glade. 2. Farewell to an idea. A cabin stands deserted on a beach. It is white, as by a custom, or according to an ancestral theme, or as a consequence of an infinite course. Flowers against the wall are white, a little dried, a kind of mark reminding, trying to remind, of a white that was different, something else, last year or before. Not the white of an aging afternoon, whether fresher or duller, whether of winter cloud or of winter sky, from horizon to horizon. The wind is blowing the sand across the floor. Here, being visible is being white, is being of the solid of white, the accomplishment of an extremist in an exercise. The season changes. A cold wind chills the beach. The long lines of it grow longer, emptier. The darkness gathers, though it does not fall, and the whiteness grows less vivid on the wall. The man who is walking turns blankly on the sand. He observes how the north is always enlarging the change with its frigid brilliances. Its blue-red sweeps and gusts of great enkindlings. Its polar green, the color of ice and fire and solitude. 3. Farewell to an idea. The mother's face purpose of the poem, fills the room. They are together here, and it is warm, with none of the prescience of oncoming dreams. It is evening. The house is evening, half dissolved. Only the half they can never possess remains, still starred. It is the mother they possess, who gives transparence to their present peace. She makes that gentler that can gentle be. And yet she too is dissolved. She is destroyed. She gives transparence, but she has grown old. The necklace is a carving, not a kiss. The soft hands are a motion, not a touch. The house will crumble and the books will burn. They are at ease in a shelter of the mind. And the house is of the mind, and they in time together, all together. Boreal night will look like frost as it approaches them. And to the mother, as she falls asleep, and as they say, good night, upstairs, the windows will be lighted, not the room. A wind will spread its windy grandeurs round, and knock like a rifle butt against the door. The wind will command them with invincible sound. 4. Farewell to an idea. The cancellings, the negations are never final. The father sits in space, wherever he sits, a bleak regard, as one that is strong in the bushes of his eyes. He says no to no and yes to yes. He says yes to no, and in saying yes, he says farewell. He measures the velocities of change. He leaps from heaven to heaven more rapidly than bad angels leap from heaven to hell in flames. Now he sits in quiet and greener day. He assumes the great speeds of space and flutters them from cloud to cloudless, cloudless to keen clear, in flights of eye and ear, the highest eye and the lowest ear, the deep ear that discerns at evening, things that attend it, until it hears the supernatural preludes of its own. At the moment when the angelic eye defines its actors approaching in company, in their masks, Master, O Master, seated by the fire, and yet in space, and motionless, and yet of motion, the ever-brightening origin, profound, and yet the king, and yet the crown, look at this present throne. What company in masks can choir it with the naked wind? 5. The mother invites humanity to her house and table. The father fetches tellers of tales and musicians who muse much on the tales. The father fetches negresses to dance among the children like curious ripenesses of pattern in the dances ripening. For these the musicians make insidious tones, clawing the sing-song of their instruments. The children laugh and jangle at any time. The father fetches pageants out of air, scenes at the theater, vistas and blocks of woods and curtains, like a naive pretense of sleep. Among these, the musicians strike the instinctive poem. The father fetches his unherded herds a barbarous tongue, slavered and panting hairs a breath. Obedient to his trumpet's touch, this then is Chatillon, or as you please. We dance in the tumult of a festival. What festival? This loud, disordered mooch. These hospitaliers. These brute-like guests. These musicians dubbing at a tragedy. A dub, which is made up of this. That there are no lines to speak. There is no play. Or the persons act one merely by being here. Six. It is a theater floating through the clouds, itself a cloud. Although of misted rock and mountains running like water, wave on wave through waves of light. It is of cloud transformed to cloud transformed again, idly, the way a season changes color to no end, except the lavishings of itself in change. As light changes yellow into gold and gold to its opal elements and fire's delight, splashed widewise because it likes magnificence and the solemn pleasures of magnificent space, the cloud drifts idly through half-thought-of forms. The theater is filled with flying birds, wild wedges, as of a volcano's smoke, palm-eyed and vanishing, a web in a corridor or massive portico. The capital, it may be, is emerging, or has just collapsed. The denouement has to be postponed. There's nothing until in a single man contained. Nothing until this named thing nameless is and is destroyed. He opens the door of his house on flames. The scholar of one candle sees an arctic effulgence flaring on the frame of everything he is. And he feels afraid. Seven. Is there an imagination that sits enthroned, as grim as it is benevolent, the just and the unjust, which in the midst of summer stops to imagine winter? When the leaves are dead, does it take its place in the north and unfold itself goat-leaper, crystalled and luminous, sitting in highest night? And do these heavens adorn and proclaim it? The white creator of black, jetted by extinguishings, even of planets as may be, even of earth, even of sight in snow, except as needed by way of majesty in the sky, as crown and diamond gabbler. It leaps through us, through all our heavens, leaps, extinguishing our planets one by one, leaving of where we were and looked, of where we knew each other and of each other thought, a shivering residue, chilled and foregone, except for that crown and mystical cabala. But it dare not leap. By chance in its own dark, it must change from destiny to slight caprice, and thus its jetted tragedy, its steel and shape and mournful making, move to make what must unmake it, and at last what can, say, a flippant communication under the moon. 8. There must be always a time of innocence. There is never a place. Or if there is no time, if it is not a thing of time nor of place, existing in the idea of it alone, in the sense against calamity, it is not less real. For the oldest and coldest philosopher, there is or may be a time of innocence as pure principle. Its nature is its end, that it should be and yet not be. A thing that pinches the pity of the pitiful man, like a book at evening, beautiful but untrue, like a book on rising, beautiful and true. It is like a thing of ether that exists almost as predicate, but it exists. It exists. It is visible. It is. It is. So, then, these lights are not a spell of light, a saying out of a cloud, but innocence. An innocence of the earth, and no false sign or symbol of malice, that we partake thereof. Lie down like children in this holiness, as if, awake, we lay in the quiet of sleep, as if the innocent mother sang in the dark of the room and on an accordion, half heard, created the time and place in which we breathed. 9. And of each other thought. In the idiom of the work, in the idiom of an innocent earth, not of the enigma of the guilty dream. We were as Danes in Denmark, all day long, and knew each other well, hale-hearted landsmen, whom the outlandish was another day of the week, queerer than Sunday. We thought alike, and that made brothers of us, in a home in which we fed on being brothers, fed and fattened as on a decorous honeycomb. This drama that we lay sticky with sleep, this sense of the activity of fate, the rendezvous, when she came alone, by her coming became a freedom of the two, an isolation which only the two could share. Shall we be found hanging in the trees next spring? Of what disaster is this, the imminence? Bare limbs, bare trees, and the wind as sharp as salt. The stars are putting on their glittering belts. They throw around their shoulders cloaks that flash like a great shadow's last embellishment. It may come tomorrow in the simplest word, almost as part of innocence, almost as the tenderest and the truest part. 10. An unhappy people in a happy world. Read, Rabbi, the phases of this difference. An unhappy people in an unhappy world. Here are too many mirrors for misery. A happy people in an unhappy world. It cannot be. There's nothing there to roll on the expressive tongue, the finding fang. Happy people in a happy world, buffo, a ball, an opera, a bar. Turn back to where we were when we began. And unhappy people in a happy world. Now, solemnize the secretive syllables. Read to the congregation for today and for tomorrow this extremity, this contrivance of the specter of the spheres, contriving balance to contrive a whole, the vital, the never-failing genius, fulfilling his meditations, great and small, in these unhappy. He meditates a whole, the full of fortune and the full of fate, as if he lived all lives that he might know in Hall Harridan, not hushful paradise, to a haggling of wind and weather, by these lights like a blaze of summer straw in winter's nick.